welcome back. I think we have a great half day in front of us. I think it's going to be very stimulating and interesting. We've got some great speakers. And this morning we're going to start with Eric Beinhocker. He's a professor at the Blavatnik School of Government at the University of Oxford, and he's also the director of the Institute for New Economic Thinking, which is, I think, a visionary organization. They're one of the only economics institutions who's breaking out of the mold and really starting to take a very serious look at what a new economy might have to look like in order to take us effectively through the 21st century. The first grant that Partners for a New Economy ever made was to Eric at the Institute for New Economic Thinking for what I think is an extremely important project. It's building a new modeling system for climate, energy, and the economy. And I think it really has the potential to change the way that we think about financial investments and transitioning to a clean energy economy. It's no longer this battle between environment and economy. Actually, what they're showing is that if you look at the data and you use this new model, that they're actually, you can integrate them, benefit the economy and benefit the climate much more quickly than you would normally by just understanding where the finance, where the capital should be flowing and basically how to make this transition. I think we're going to look back in 20 years and Eric is going to be one of those people who's actually helped us really shift. I don't want to put him in the same camp as the neoliberal folks, but I think there's a potential that INET, so Eric and everybody who he's working with is on that track to making that significant of an impact. So welcome, Eric.
Well, thank you very much, Leslie, for the generous introduction, and thank you for inviting me. This is going to be a bit more of a philosophical talk today. It's not going to be a very practical talk, but when things are difficult, sometimes a bit of philosophy is what we need. And as Leslie mentioned, this is based on some work that I'm doing with the co-author Nick Hanauer on a book that we've got coming out hopefully early next year. I'm going to start with a quote from the literary critic Fred Jameson. Said, someone once said that it is easier to imagine the end of the world than to imagine the end of capitalism. And I was struck by the truth of this statement, that we have lots of ways of imagining the end of the world. You know, we have scientific scenarios telling us how it's all going to unravel. We heard some of that yesterday, in fact. We have Hollywood action movies, you know, giving us a picture of what the end of the world looks like. We have books like Cormac McCarthy's The Road that give us a sense for how it might feel. But how do we imagine a different economic system, something very different, so different we have to give it a new name, that's a transformation from our current system of consumer-driven, fossil fuel-based, extractive capitalism? And the reason why it's so hard to imagine that is our economic system is so all-encompassing and we're so immersed in it and we've been living with it for so long that it's very, very hard to see any alternatives. What is an economy? What is it? Well, at its heart, an economy is people. It's made out of people. But it's more than that. It's the ideas that people have. The historian Yuval Harari has a nice phrase, imagined orders. That all of our social orders are actually products of human imagination. They don't actually exist in reality. The economy doesn't exist in reality. The economy, what we call the economy, is a set of ideas. It's a set of concepts that we've imagined and we've invented over history. All of these ideas and concepts up in that little bubble there, they come out of our heads, were things that were invented by human imagination over history. So the economy really is a product of our thoughts and ideas. Now, that imagined order, our thoughts and ideas, have an interaction with the physical order. Our ideas about the economy produce something physical in this table, in this building, and so on. And our imagined orders have evolved over time. They've changed from our ideas about how to make a living were based around hunting and gathering, and then agriculture, and then industry, and modern capitalism. These were all different ways of organizing society, organizing our institutions and our culture. And those have had a feedback loop with the physical order of our planet. And this is what's been responsible for shifting us from the Holocene to the Anthropocene. Now, if we're going to change this system, we have to change the set of ideas. We have to change our imagined order. That's how we change the economy. We change our ideas, we change the economy. Now, if we look at what's inside our imagined order today, the set of ideas, I like to use the metaphor of a set of Russian dolls. That there's layers within layers within layers. And at the outer layer of our Russian doll of ideas is the economic system itself, this system that we call, you know, modern capitalism. And then inside that, if we unpack and look under that, there's a set of economic and political ideologies. And I'll talk more about what we mean by that in a minute. And then if we unpack that further, inside that doll is a set of economic theories, a set of explanations for how we think the economy works and how it should work. And then inside that is a set of theories about human beings. Underneath all economics is a set of ideas about human nature. And then at the very bottom of the doll are a set of ideas about moral philosophy, about what's good and bad in the world. Now, our current imagined order in the economic system, we have what we call modern capitalism. Our ideology has been dominated by neoliberalism, particularly in the West, and I am going to focus my comments mostly on the Western countries, in the developed world. We can come back later to the emerging economies. The economic theory that has dominated our discourse has been neoclassical economics, the behavioral theory, what we call homo economicus, and our moral philosophy underneath all this is what can be called maximizing utilitarianism. Now, if we look at the history of these ideas, where did they come from? How did we get this system that we have today, this system of thought? Well, the three kind of intellectual cores, the economic theory, the behavioral theory, and the moral philosophy, really came out of a set of changes in economics in the late 1800s, the rise of what's called the marginalist movement, and then that transitioned into neoclassical economics. And over the course of about a century, those ideas really came to dominate the intellectual and academic world and how we think about the economy. That then led to the development of neoliberalism, which you know many of you are familiar with and lots been written about. That really sort of split into two branches. There's been a kind of progressive version of neoliberalism focused more on equity and protection of people on the left, and a more conservative version of neoliberalism more focused on efficiency and growth on the right, and you know that framework, that ideological framework, came to dominate particularly the U.S., Britain, and to a large extent in Europe in the 70s through 2010s. These systems then lead to a form of capitalism that we have today, and you know there's a literature and academia varieties of capitalism, and we have you know some countries that are more on the progressive end of capitalism with more state, say for example Sweden or the Scandinavian countries. And then more conservative versions, you know, emphasizing less state, you know, the U.S. being the prime example. And that spectrum of models came to dominate in the 1980s through 2010s geopolitically. Now, our politics have kind of played out in this imagined order, in this framework. And you know, the big battles have really been up at the level of ideology in the economic system. So you know, between ideology and the system are sets of policies. You know, what do we actually do? And there's been big battles on trade-offs between, you know, equity and growth, between environment and growth, between social justice and growth. You know, usually that's the framing that gets put down in our political system. And so most of our, you know, battles have been in this sandbox. Now the problem is both these routes lead to mass extinction. Yes. Sweden, a wonderful country, is no more on the route to fundamentally changing the economic system than the U.S. is. You know, think of the most environmentally friendly countries we have on the planet today. You know, there's been lots of analysis of this. You know, they're still on the path to destruction too. This whole system, whichever branch you're on, right or left or wherever, is on the path to mass extinction. So what do? We need to bring the fight back down here. We need to go right down to the root and change the whole thing and build from the bottom up. We first have to start by taking down the existing system. Now, as we dig into it, we find this whole thing is based on some very shaky foundations. That down at the bottom here, this whole thing rests on the set of moral philosophy I'll talk about in a minute is very dubious. That in turn is built on by what would be, I would call, a lot of pseudoscience about human behavior and economics. And then on top of that, there's a set of ideologies that claim a scientific basis in economics, but are really stories about justifying power and privilege for a set of elites and vested interests. So I'm going to go through these from the foundations up very briefly. So an important part of understanding where this all came from is to look at the history. How did we get the ideas that we have today? Where did they come from? Well, first at the moral foundation, we had this huge transition from ideas that virtue is good to greed is good. Now, if you look in the history of moral philosophy, before basically Hobbes and Bentham and the Enlightenment, debates about human morality really focused around a few things. That human nature is essentially a battle between our desires to be good and our temptations to behave badly, our better angels and our devils of our desire. And many religious traditions laid out foundations for moral life, but essentially, a lot of them have a lot of similarities between the golden rule and treating others as you'd like to be treated yourself, and a lot of stuff about curbing our worst impulses, curbing our appetites. And morality was also thought to be part of our character, this notion of virtue, a way of living and behaving. This was Aristotle's big idea. And morality was also expressed through our social rules and norms of behavior. You know, society had strictures on what was good and what was bad and celebrated what was good. You know, Kant articulated this. But then along came Hobbes and Bentham, and they turned this whole system on its head. They turned this whole logic upside down. That instead, they saw human nature as to seek pleasure and avoid pain. And they said, it's neither good nor bad, that's just how we are. We seek pleasure, we avoid pain. And what's good or bad is the consequences of our actions for the pleasure and pain of others. And the moral outcome is the outcome that maximizes the most pleasure for the most people and minimizes the most pain for the most people. And things like character, intentions, rules, norms, none of that matters. That's all irrelevant. All that matters is the consequentialism of our actions for the pleasure and pain of others. And humans are these maximizing animals. That was their view. Now, this idea of the maximizing human and that the goal of life is pleasure, essentially, got picked up by a group of economists, the marginalists and later neoclassicists, who developed a theory that people maximize their individual pleasure, or what's called an economics utility. They get that pleasure from consumption. That's where utility comes from. So consuming things is a moral good. And societal utility is then the sum of individual utilities. And so a good society, in some sense, is the society that gets the most pleasure from consumption. And the moral good is the max social utility. And then this guy Pareto came up with the idea that in a free society, the max good is is the maximum utility you can get without coercing people to give up things that they don't want to give up. And then later economists showed that free markets, left to their own devices, achieve this maximum social outcome. So that laid a set of ideas and moral foundations that have been kind of with us in economics now really over a couple of centuries. And on top of that, this idea that humans have these pleasure maximizers turned into what I call behavioral pseudoscience, rational and make calculations about pleasure and pain, what Bentham called the physics of pleasure and pain or utility, and that they're rational decision makers. And this has been the foundation of much of economics for the last couple of over a century. And here's just a quote from some of the originators of it, Francis Edgeworth, You know, the first principle of economics is that every agent is actuated by self-interest. The conception of man as a pleasure machine may justify and facilitate the employment of mechanical terms in mathematical reasoning and social science. Part of the reason they assumed all this stuff is they could turn economics from a branch of philosophy into what they saw as a mathematical science. Another implication of this is that we were all individuals. Jeremy Bentham said that the community is a fictitious body. It's just we're composed of individual persons who are considered as constituting as if it were members. So there's no, as Margaret Thatcher famously said, there's no such thing as society. We're just individuals maximizing our individual pleasure. That's it. Now, where did this come from? Did they go out and, you know, look at how humans behave? Did they collect data and evidence? Did they, you know, conduct, you know, thick anthropological studies? Was there any science in any of this? No. Steven Pinker has a wonderful phrase, armchair anthropology. As he put it, these guys basically sat in armchairs, you know, with a cup of tea or a cup of whiskey or whatever their preferred drink was, and they sat there and said, I think human beings are pleasure-maximizing machines. Let's build a theory around that. You know, I think we're all just individuals. There's no such thing as society. Let's build a theory around that. There's no science under this. They made it up. It's armchair anthropology. Yet it's hugely shaped our thinking for over a century. As economics picked up these theories of behaviors, we had more pseudoscience. We had a set of ideas that economic systems are equilibrium systems, that they optimize, that they're static systems, change comes from the outside, and that they're what mathematicians call linearly additive, that, you know, this goes again to Bentham's idea, we're all just individuals adding up, there's nothing more, nothing emergent to our collective. And that the economy is something closed and separable from other systems, from the environment, from political systems, etc. And here's you know, some of the implications of that are very well known to you about you know, that economies are essentially allocative systems that are efficient, and you know, justice and equality doesn't matter. What matters is economic efficiency. You know, governments are inefficient and therefore to be minimized. Price is value to society, so things like GDP are a good proxy for welfare. We can make our decisions on you know, marginal and cost-benefit analysis, and growth can be infinite. You know, there's a whole set of implications that flowed out of this that still shape the way we think about things, and particularly economists and others think about things today. Now, this was also pseudoscience, so where did this come from? Well, basically a guy named Leon Walras and some other guys, Stanley Jevons, back in the late 1800s, took some physics textbooks and tried to make economics again into mathematical physics, and they copied equations. This is the textbook that Walras got his equations from. It's actually a French statistical mechanics book. I actually got it out of a British library once. And he was even quite explicit about this, that he was trying to turn economics into a kind of physics of social relations, and in order to do that, he had to drastically simplify things to make his math work and make these assumptions. So again, they didn't go out and look at the economy and say, is it actually an equilibrium system? They said, no, we're just going to assume this because we've got some math that can work this way. You know, the idea that pursuing self-interest, maximizing self-interest, maximizing consumption is actually good. Greed is good. That maximizing consumption, you know, is moral. And that a billion acts of selfishness make a prosperous society. You know, the idea, you know, people think this was Adam Smith and the Invisible Hand. That's actually a myth that Milton Friedman propagated. When you actually read Smith, and there's been some good scholarship on this, he believed nothing of the sort. In fact, he wrote an entire book, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, about why empathy is actually and moral virtue are what important. He did not believe greed is good, or Milton Friedman's interpretation of the invisible hand. We get the idea that the social duty of business is to maximize its profits. There's no such thing as society, only individuals. Again, Margaret Thatcher's famous quote. Markets are efficient, other institutions, government, civil society, are not. The value of something to society is its market price. You are paid what you are worth. The idea of power in society, that, you know, power could be involved in setting wages, was assumed out of the system. One of my favorite quotes on this is, Lloyd Blankfein, chairman of Goldman Sachs, said, Goldman Sachs employees must be the most productive employees in the world because they are so highly paid. Well, it's right, yeah. Think of the logic of that. We have to choose between equity and growth. There was a famous book written in the 70s that just about every economist read called The Big Trade-Off, that you can't have both of these things. You can either have a just society or a growth society. And the way this has played out politically is, you know, in the US, the Republicans were the party of growth, and the Democrats were the party of equity. You have to choose. And the environment is a resource to be exploited. You know, the economist's production function can take infinite resources and you know, turn them into products and services. And the environment is this thing, an externality. Now, this is all just a story. And it's really a story of power and privilege. If you go back in history, every era has had stories like this. You know, they've had a narrative about why the order we have today is a natural one. The order today is the best order, and change will only hurt those it intends to help, and there is no alternative. Elites have been telling these stories forever. On the right is the Code of Hammurabi, which is one of the first written recordings of such a story about why the king and his cronies, the natural order was for them to be on top because God said they should be, and there was a whole set of rules about how society should be organized and why this was the best order and there is no alternative. And elites have always looked to sources of authority for these stories they tell, whether it's, you know, God or blood. You know, our aristocratic families are the superior families and that's the natural order, or soil, you know, or race, these people are superior to these people, or because our ancestors did it and it's tradition, or philosophy, or science, think of social Darwinism, and economics. Economics has become our modern god, our modern source of authority for these stories that justify a social order and power and privilege. Now, here's just a little example of how, in modern terms, this kind of narrative plays out. So, Milton Friedman said back in the 60s, I'm convinced that the minimum wage law is the most anti-Negro law in our statute books, in its effect, not its intent. The order we have today is the best order without a minimum wage. Any change will hurt those it intends to help, you silly people. You know, if you silly soft-headed liberals, you know, put in a minimum wage, the laws of supply and demand, you know, if you raise the price of something, right, you know, supply is going to shrink. We're going to have fewer jobs. It's going to hurt the people it intends to help. Now, this wasn't just in the 60s. This is very current. So here's another quote. Of course, Black Lives Matter. That's why the $15 minimum wage is a bad idea. Again, you know, the same logic. Now, inconveniently, here's a few facts. And we can thank actually Heather Boucher's shop for a lot of great work on this. Low-wage employment is actually unchanged by the minimum wage. No jobs are lost. Incomes at the bottom significantly increase. Working poverty is reduced. Dependence on public assistance is reduced. And low-income African Americans are among the largest beneficiaries of this. So, you know, we have these stories, you know, justified in the, quote, science of economics that are really stories about preserving a certain order and preserving power and privilege. Now, I love this quote from John Stuart Mill. It often happens that the universal belief of one age of mankind becomes to a subsequent age so palpable an absurdity that the only difficulty then is to imagine how such a thing could ever have appeared credible. And when you really look at these ideas in our current thought system, it does look absurd. And it is taking us to a very dangerous place. Now, how do we replace it? Well, the good news is we have a lot of new ideas and new thinking that can replace it if we're willing to open up our thinking and change. So first of all, on our human behavior little Russian doll, we've had a real revolution in our understanding of human behavior over the past couple of decades, showing us what Homo sapiens look like, not Homo economicus, and real human decision. And we have lots of evidence now around this from cognitive science, psychology, anthropology, social psychology, and so on, that humans are not rational decision makers. They're inductive, they're heuristic. Our brains are not actually a single entity, but quite modular and make decisions in distributed ways. We're hugely adaptive and learn. our emotions are actually a very important part of our decision-making apparatus. They're not a kind of flaw in our thinking the way economists treat them. They're actually essential to making good decisions. And above all, we are hugely social creatures. And most of our decision-making is made in a social context. It's made with others. And real human behavior, we can be selfish. We can be self-interested. Everyone can be. But we are hugely groupish. Human beings are among the most social species on the planet. And our sociality is underpinned by strong instincts and norms about reciprocity, cooperation, altruism. We have very strong intuitive moral instincts, which then get picked up in our culture. And we also are hierarchical. We're primates. All primates are hierarchical. And we're also tribal. We also have some real science on what kind of a system the economy is. The economy is not an equilibrium system. That is just factually true. I love this quote from the scientist John Holland: if it's in equilibrium, it must be dead. This is what an equilibrium system looks like. That's an equilibrium. That's a system at rest. This is what the economy looks like. It's a complex adaptive system. This is a picture of London at night. And what complex adaptive systems are is they're dynamic, they're nonlinear, they're networks, they emerge from the bottom up, they're reflexive, they're self-creating, self-organized, evolutionary, emergent. They're also thermodynamic systems. They require energy to come in to create order and change, and then they create waste products back into the environment. They're embedded in human culture, society, and deeply embedded in the environment. The fact that the economy is a complex adaptive system and not an equilibrium system is so obvious you can see it from space. You know, space aliens would look at the planet and say, ah, this is a complex adaptive system going on. They would not look down and say, this is an equilibrium system. And the good news, again, is we have a huge amount of research and science in applying these ideas in social systems and understanding social systems from this modern perspective. So a new thought system building on these ideas is possible. We can build up a new moral philosophy around our understanding of human it's called pro-sociality, our cooperative and social instincts. We can build up behavioral theories about real Homo sapiens and our real decision-making and behaviors. We can show how when you put a group of humans together into networks and that they create institutions which evolve and they create higher levels of social and physical order in complex systems. And these create, in turn, emergent behaviors, whether it's economic growth, economic inequality, booms and busts in financial markets, or environmental destruction. We also think you can start to build a new kind of economic and political ideology on this. So my co-author and I, and this is the project that we're working on, is how do we take these kind of more scientific and academic ideas and do what the neoliberals did and build a set of political and economic ideologies. And we've got a sort of working title for that that we call market humanism. And then how does that lead to a different kind of economic system? Something we call the eudaimonic economy from Aristotle's word eudaimonia, meaning for human flourishing. How do we create an economy that is built around the notion of human flourishing at its core? Now, we think if you do build such a new thought system, that a new set of memes and norms pop out of it. And we don't have time to go in the connection between these sort of more academic ideas and all the way up to these memes, but I'll give you a little taster, a little preview. Greed is bad. Surprise, folks. Greed is actually very bad for human cooperation. Being a selfish jerk does not create cooperation. That's the end of 200 years of economic philosophy. And maximizing our individual consumption and pleasure is not what humans are motivated by, not what being a human is about. It's actually really maximizing, going back to Aristotle's older idea, of a broader notion of human flourishing, a multi-dimension notion of well-being. We argue prosperity comes from solving human problems, that our life gets better when we solve problems like, you know, how to feed ourselves, how to take care of ourselves, how to help ourselves, you know, help people when they're sick. You know, creating antibiotics solved the major problem of human health. that was a real increase in prosperity. It doesn't come from necessarily making the next new fancy derivative product, which the neoclassical theory would say is it would. And the way we solve human problems and create true prosperity is actually by cooperation. We can't solve complex problems by ourselves. The great genius of human beings is we create mechanisms for cooperation at very large scales and over long periods of time to solve very complex problems. Getting breakfast to your table this morning, which solved your problem of being hungry, probably involved several thousand people that you've never met, scattered across this country, maybe even across the globe, all working cooperatively together to deliver you your yogurt and toast and whatever you had, coffee. So a billion acts of cooperation is what makes a prosperous society. And to get high levels of cooperation across a society, you need inclusion and fairness and trust. And so there is no big trade-off. That actually these things go together. Inclusion, fairness, and trust go with economic growth and cooperation and prosperity increasing. And a key role of governments throughout history has been to create the security and foundations for such a cooperative, high-trust society to evolve. And the role of markets, then, is not about efficiency and allocation. It's really to create cooperations, to come up with better, competitions, to come up with better forms of cooperation. When markets work well, they are evolutionary mechanisms for evolving new forms of cooperation and new solutions to human problems. Markets, done well, can increase human prosperity, and they have over time when they work in this way. They're not about efficiency and allocation. They're about effectiveness in innovation and fostering new forms of cooperation and problem solving. And therefore, the social duty of business is to solve human problems. What are businesses there for? Why do we have them? To provide us better solutions to our problems. And the moral duty of humankind is to protect life on Earth. That's our ultimate moral duty, and I think anyone who saw the presentations yesterday would see that as an inescapable conclusion. Now, you might ask, okay, Eric, this is all fine words and philosophy and Hobbes and Adam Smith and all that, but we need solutions. We need policies. Where are the policies, Eric? The reality is we have them. In this room, we have them, and in the organizations we work with. We know what to do to decarbonize the economy. We know what we need to do to increase social justice, and we know what we need to do to create a truly sustainable system. The problem is those ideas have been getting nowhere. And they've been getting nowhere because of this system, the current thought system, where we have these intellectual foundations that provide legitimacy for the political ideology and narratives. They get pushed through our education system. Every Econ 101 class in the country teaches this stuff. I'm sure here at Irvine, if we looked at the curriculum, we'd see that all the stuff I just shot down is exactly what the students' heads are getting filled with. Those students then grow up and they become business people or politicians or media figures or whatever. They get embedded in our institutions, and then they provide a huge filter on the policies that get through the system. And they systematically favor the status quo policies and systematically filter out the transformation policies and ideas. I had a rather depressing conversation at a UK government ministry the other week where they had some actually quite bold and quite good ideas on addressing climate change in the UK. And they were very depressed because they couldn't get it through the filter of the Treasury, what's called the Green Book, which is this, basically neoliberalism kind of boiled down into a set of rules for what policies you approve and fund in the British system. It was providing a huge filter that was systematically taking out the policies that would lead to a real change and transformation. So we need new intellectual foundations that give legitimacy and educate the next generation and embed themselves in institutions that open up the space for these transformative policies and ideas that we have. And there are probably ideas that we haven't thought of yet that this new frame of thinking will open up, and that will be very important too. Now, why do we think we can do this? Why might we think that such a change in the thought system leading to a change in policies and practices is possible? Because it's happened in our very recent history. I've actually seen it in my own lifetime, that we had a set of work, in neoclassical economics and neoliberal ideology that then systematically filtered through into particularly U.S. elite thinking, but other parts of the world too, through a set of institutions, through education, and so on, and had a huge impact in rewiring how the world runs. And if you read the history of this, you see this was quite this didn't happen by accident. It was actually quite deliberate and strategic. Larry Kramer of the Hewlett Foundation wrote an excellent memo summarizing this, which is available on the Hewlett website. So if we rewire our thought system in a new direction, not only do we then create the political possibilities, the political conditions and institutional conditions where a new thought system emerges, and where the ideas and policies that many of us have been working on for many, many years suddenly become possible. Now I'm going to close with two quotes. First is, over 100 years ago, the German poet Heine warned the French not to underestimate the power of ideas. Philosophical concepts nurtured in the stillness of a professor's study could destroy a civilization. We're seeing how the philosophical concepts from 200 years ago are now coming back to lead to the destruction of our own civilization. And then last, from Keynes, the difficulty lies not in the new ideas, but in escaping from the old ones, which ramify for those brought up, as most of us have been, into every corner of our minds. We need to escape from these old ideas and begin the hard work of constructing the new ones. Thank you.